I will now pass it over to our second Sheikh, who is Sheikh Abdul Latif Shamani Hafidhahullah, who is a teacher and has a kursi, a chair in Al Masjid Al Nabawi, the Masjid of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And likewise, he teaches in the Faculty of Sharia, Hadith Usul Al Fiqh, in the Faculty of Sharia in the Islamic University of Al Medina. So without any delay, I'll pass it over to the Sheikh. Faliyatakallahu mashkura ajura.
The mic's on.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، وسلم تسليما كثيرا. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا ذا الجلال والإكرام، كما أسأله جل وعلا أن ينفعنا بما سمعنا من شيخنا في هذه الفوائد القيمة الجليلة. نسأل الله عز وجل أن يجعلها حجة لنا جميعا وشاهدا لنا لا حجة علينا.
The Shaykh started off praising Allah and sending salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah grants us knowledge of that which will benefit us and allow us to benefit from that which we have learned and to increase us in knowledge. And likewise, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to benefit from the words mentioned by our Shaykh, Shaykh Muqbil Hafidhahullah, and to make this knowledge a proof for us on the Day of Judgment, not a proof against us.
ثم إنا نحمد الله عز وجل أيها الأحبة أن هدانا لهذا الدين القويم، ما اجتمعنا في هذا المكان إلا ونحن نرجو ما عند الله عز وجل، لنصل إلى رضاه، لنصل إلى جنته. اجتمعنا وجمعنا هذا الدين، دين الإسلام، الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله.
And we also praise and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to this great religion, because we have not gathered here today except that we hope for the reward that is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we hope to gain the pleasure of Allah, and we hope to make this gathering a means of attaining paradise. And we also thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for choosing us and allowing us to be guided to the religion of Al-Islam. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions in the Quran that all praise is due to Allah for this, for guiding us to Islam. And if it was not for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guiding us, we would not have been guided.
من نعم الله عز وجل علينا أيضا أن بعث إلينا أفضل رسله وخاتمهم نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، الذي ما من خير إلا ودلنا عليه، وما من شر إلا وحذرنا منه، تركنا على محجة بيضاء نقية ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك.
And also from the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that he sent to us the best of messengers and the final messenger, which is our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was no good except that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he guided us towards it. And there was no evil except that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he warned us from it. And he left us upon a clear white plain field, where its night is as clear as its day, and therefore nobody is misguided from that path except for the one who is destroyed.
من النعم العظيمة التي هي محور حديثنا هذا اليوم، وهي نعمة يغفل عنها كثير من الناس، ألا وهي نعمة البيوت والأسر، أن تجتمع مع أسرتك في مكان واحد وتحت سقف واحد، وتكون آمنا مستقرا مع هذه الأسرة.
And also from the great blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the topic of our discussion today, is a blessing that many of us sometimes are heedless of. And that is the blessings of our household and of our families. And the fact that we can gather together with our families in a state of safety and stability.
هذه الأسرة المكونة من الأبوين والأبناء من الإخوة والأخوات بحاجة إلى اجتماع، بحاجة إلى تواصل، بحاجة إلى تعاون، بحاجة إلى محبة وألفة.
And this house, this household, which is made up normally of two parents and children, brothers and sisters, they are in need of coming together. And they are in need of keeping the ties and keeping connections with one another. And they are in need of having love between them.
هذه الأسرة هناك بعض العوامل التي تؤثر عليها. من هذه العوامل ما يعرف بالتقنية أو التكنولوجيا سلبا وإيجابا. هناك آثار إيجابية وهناك آثار سلبية. فلا شك أن التقنية تقرب البعيد، توفر الوقت، تعين على التواصل، تعين على صلة الرحم، تعين على البحث في المسائل العلمية أو البحث في ما ينفع الإنسان. هذه إيجابيات، فالواجب أن نستعمل هذه التقنية فيما يعود علينا بالنفع والخير.
And this household, this unity, this love between the family members, there are many things that can affect that relationship between the members of the household. And from the greatest things that affects this relationship is technology. And this can affect the household in a good way, and it can also affect the household in a bad way. And there's no doubt from the benefits of technology is that it allows us to save time. It allows us to connect with other people. It allows us to become closer to people who are far away. It allows us to tie the ties of kinship. It allows us to research academic issues. It allows us to research anything that will benefit us, and so on. All of these are from the benefits of technology. So therefore, what's obligatory upon us regarding this technology is to use it in a manner which benefits us.
لكن حديثنا هنا يتركز على الآثار السلبية التي تورثها هذه التقنيات. وحينما نتكلم عن هذا فعلينا أن نحذر وأن نجتهد في أن لا توصلنا هذه التقنية إلى هذه الآثار السلبية التي سنتحدث عنها إن شاء الله تعالى.
However, what we want to talk about today is the negative effects of technology upon a household, which the cause of it is this technology, modern day technology that we have. And when we study these effects that they have upon the household and upon the family, what's obligatory upon us is to beware and to stay away from these effects. And we try our best to make sure that these negative effects do not take place upon our families.
من هذه الآثار أولا ما يعرف بالتباعد الأسري. ربما انشغل كل واحد من أفراد الأسرة بجواله أو جهازه، فأصبح بعيدا بعقله وقلبه عن أسرته، حتى وإن كان مجالسا لهم في المنزل. ف فهذا لا شك يؤدي إلى ماذا؟ إلى التفكك، إلى التباعد، وهذا ما يسعى له الأعداء الذين توسعوا في نشر هذه الوسائل، وسائل التواصل المتنوعة، كل ذلك لكي يحصل هذا التباعد بين الأسر المسلمة ويحصل التفكك. نسأل الله أن يعيذنا وإياكم من ذلك.
The first of these negative effects is that it causes the family members to draw further apart. Even though they are all within the same house, you'll find that each one of them is busy on their phones or upon their devices. And therefore, even though physically they may be close to one another, but with their minds, with their intellects, and with their hearts, they are far away. Even if they are living in the same house or they are even sitting in the same room. And this is something that the enemies of Islam, they want from the Islamic households. They want them to become busy. And they want the households to become weaker and our relationship to be further apart, to make it easier to destroy the Islam and that love which is between them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from this.
ومن العجيب وفي نفس الوقت من المؤسف أن الأب قبل التقنية وانشغال الأسرة بهذه التقنيات كان إذا دخل بيته استقبله أبناؤه من عند الباب ينظرون ماذا جلب إليهم والده من طعام أو شراب أو ما يفرحه، لكن اليوم يدخل الأب من الباب في غير وقت نوم وأفراد الأسرة كلهم موجودون في المنزل، فيتتبعهم واحدا واحدا يبحث عنهم، يجد كل واحد منهم قد أمسك زاوية وقد صاحب جواله أو جهازه، وهذا للأسف يعني واقع كثير من الأسر.
And something which is strange but at the same time very saddening is that in the past a father, if he was to come back home after work at a time when the children were not sleeping, what he would find is that he would find his children waiting for him at the door out of happiness that their father has returned, maybe anticipating some gifts that the father may have brought from sweets, food or anything else that may delight them. But now what has happened is that the father, if he walks into the house, he can't find anybody in the house. And when he goes around looking for his children, each of them have taken an abode in a corner of the house, glued on to their phones. And this is something which is very saddening, and the reality is that this happens a lot.
من الآثار السلبية والسيئة لهذه التقنية على الأسرة تشتت الأذهان وذهاب الأوقات دون فائدة، التوسع في التقنية، إدمان هذه الأجهزة يجعل عقولنا مشتتة. والسؤال هنا لماذا؟ الجواب لأن المشاهد فيها في الغالب يشتت الذهن، ربما يشاهد الواحد صورة محرمة أو مقطعا سيئا، بعدما ينظر هذا الابن أو هذه البنت أو أي فرد من أفراد الأسرة إلى هذه المقاطع أو هذه الصور التي جلبتها هذه التقنية، سيجد أنه يتبع هذا المشهد أو هذا المقطع مقاطع أخرى، فلا يزال الذهن يتشتت وتذهب الأوقات دون أن يشعر الواحد منه. هذا أمر ملاحظ مشاهد، قد يمر عليك ساعة أو ساعتين أو ثلاث وأنت لا تشعر بالوقت أمام هذه التقنية.
The second negative effect of technology is that it causes our minds not to be able to focus, and it also causes us to waste our time without any benefit. If you find that those who are looking on their phones, and there are many reasons why it causes a person for their attention span to become weaker and weaker and weaker. And from the reasons is that most of the time what a person would see on his phone is from those things which is not beneficial, and it causes his attention span to become weaker. Maybe a person, he sees a picture which is haram, or maybe a person, he sees a video which contains evil within it. And not only that, after he sees that video or that picture, he'll scroll and then he'll see another one, and then he'll see another one after that. And this is something which all of us, we can see happening to us. So therefore our mind, our attention span, this becomes weaker, and our focus is lost, and time is also wasted without even us realizing. Sometimes an hour will go by, sometimes two, sometimes even 3 hours will go by, and you won't even realize due to us being indulged in these in technology.
وهذا أيها الأحبة يؤدي إلى أثر ثالث. هذا الأثر يؤدي إلى أثر ثالث متعلق به، وهو خلو العقل والقلب مما ينفع. خلو القلب والعقل مما ينفع المسلم. إذا سلمنا عقولنا وقلوبنا إلى هذه التقنية وهذه الأجهزة، ستكثر عندنا الخواطر السيئة. ستكثر عندنا الخواطر السيئة، وهذه الخواطر، خواطر القلب، يسبقها نظر العين. يسبقها نظر العين، ويسمى كما يسميها ابن القيم اللحظات. يسميها اللحظات. ثم يتبع ذلك الألفاظ السيئة، ثم الخطوات إلى الشر والعياذ بالله.
And this causes the third negative effect of technology, which is that our minds and our hearts, they become empty of that which will benefit us. Our hearts and minds become empty of that which will benefit us. Because what happens is that the more we look at these things that will not benefit us, or worse, those things which are impermissible and evil, then outside of using this technology and these phones, what we will be thinking of is those videos or those pictures that we have seen. So therefore, outside of the usage of technology, a person's thoughts is full of evil thoughts. And all of this starts from what Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions that the first thing that it starts off with is something known as lahazat, moments, i.e. moments of looking. And then after that, it turns into lafazat, it turns into these words that we say. So it starts off with these evil thoughts, and then it turns into evil speech that we say, and then it turns into khutuwat, it turns into evil steps that we take.
إذن أيها الأحبة، احفظوها واعقلوها وتدبروها. لحظات، ثم خطرات، ثم لفظات، ثم خطوات.
So therefore memorize these steps that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah he mentioned. In total Ibn Qayyim he mentioned these 4 steps of how shaitan leads a person to do evil actions. So memorize and ponder over these 4 steps. The first is lahazat, the first is moments, i.e. moments of looking. And then the second is khatarat, the thoughts, the evil thoughts that come out of the look that you gave. And then the third is lafazat, the words that come out, the evil words that come out. And number 4 are the khutuwat, the evil steps that a person takes.
Lahazat, lahazat al-ayn. حينما ينظر يشاهد العين تلحظ، وهذه العين توصل الأمر إلى القلب، فتأتي هناك خواطر. إذا كان هذا النظر محرماً، نظرت إلى شيء محرم، ستكون الخاطرة ماذا؟ صالحة أو سيئة؟ تكون سيئة. فلا تزال تتزايد الخطرات على القلب حتى يصبح مليء بالخواطر السيئة. لو جاءت أي خاطرة صالحة أو طيبة فإنها لا تجد مكانا، فلا تمكث، سترحل، لأنه مليء بالخواطر السيئة. هذه الخواطر ربما توصل الإنسان إلى الألفاظ السيئة، فيبدأ يتحدث يتكلم، ثم تخطو قدماه والعياذ بالله ربما إلى الحرام، إلى الفاحشة، إلى الملذات المحرمة. هذه كلها سببها الأول لحظة العين. وهنا يجب على المسلم أن يتذكر أن الله عز وجل مطلع عليه، فهو القائل جل وعلا: يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور.
So therefore, it starts off by these moments, i.e. moments of what a person sees with his eyes. And then what he sees with his eyes turn into thoughts, and these thoughts, they settle in a person's heart. And it is obvious that if a person is just looking at haram, or just looking at things which are evil, then therefore the thoughts that he has are not going to be righteous thoughts, they're going to be also evil thoughts. So therefore all of these evil thoughts, they come upon a person's heart. And then they stack up upon a person's heart until a person's heart is full of these evil thoughts and evil intentions. So even if a good thought, a good intention was to come to a person, it will come to his heart and he will find no space left upon the heart for it to settle. So therefore even that good thought will go away and it won't benefit him. And then once the heart is full of these evil thoughts, then, and we ask Allah to protect us from this, it'll cause a person to say evil things in accordance with that of which he is thinking, and sometimes it will even take a person to act in accordance and walk to that which is evil from the immoral actions and other haram actions. So therefore all of this, as you can see, where does it stem from? Where does it originate? It starts off from what a person sees. So it starts off from his eyes. And therefore it's obligatory upon us that even if we are alone, that we remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He can see everything and He knows everything that we are doing, thinking and looking at. And He is the one who said that He يَعْلَمُ خَوَيَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows those things that the eyes and the hearts hide, even those things that nobody else can see. And sometimes you yourself don't even realize, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows all of that.
من الآثار التابعة لما سبقه القلب المؤدي إلى فساد الجوارح. القلب أيها الأحبة ملك، والأعضاء والجوارح جنود. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: ألا وإن في الجسد مضغة، يعني قطعة لحم صغيرة، لكن إذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله، إذا صلحت صلح الجسد كله، وإذا فسدت فسد الجسد كله. نسأل الله السلامة والعافية. وأوسع القنوات إلى القلب باب النظر، كما يقول القرطبي رحمه الله، قال: أوسع الأبواب إلى القلب باب النظر. فهل نحن أيها الإخوة من هذه الأجهزة وهي التقنية، هل نحن حفظنا أبصارنا؟ إذا خلونا بأنفسنا، ما هو حالنا مع هذه التقنية، مع هذه الأجهزة التي تستطيع بأن تضع فقط أصبعك على هذا الجهاز يأتيك بكل ما تريد من خير وشر؟ إذا نحن حفظنا البصر وجاهدنا أنفسنا على ذلك، كان هذا سببا في سلامة قلوبنا وفي صحتها. وإذا نحن أطلقنا هذا البصر فيما حرم الله عز وجل فهذا سيؤدي إلى مرض القلب وربما موته والعياذ بالله.
And the next negative effect that it has upon us, connected to the previous point, is fasad al-qalb. It causes the heart to become corrupt. And if the heart becomes corrupt, then the limbs and our actions also become corrupt. Because the heart is like the king, and its troops is the rest of the body and the limbs. As the Prophet ﷺ indicated towards in a very famous hadith where he said that verily there is a morsel of flesh within the body. If it is sound, then the rest of the body will also be sound. And if it is corrupt, then the rest of the body will also be corrupt. And that is the heart. And the greatest, biggest, or most vast channels to the heart is Bab al-Nazar. It is looking with our eyes, as you mentioned previously. Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah, he said, أَوْسَعُ الْأَبْوَابِ, the most vast of doors or channels to a person's heart is the door of looking. So therefore we need to ask ourselves that when we are on our devices, especially when we are alone, away from those people who protect and preserve our sights, or away from those that when we are alone, we transgress against the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's very easy, just with one click of the finger, everything that a person wants can come up on their phone, from evil or from goodness. So therefore, if we strive hard and we protect our eyesight and what we are looking at, then that is a means of our hearts being safe and remaining purified. But if we allow our eyes to look at whatever pops up and whatever comes on our screens, then that is a means for our hearts to become ill. And in fact, it could even be a means for our heart to die completely. We ask Allah to protect us from that.
والقلب والعين بينهما ترابط ونفوذ عجيب. إذا صح منك النظر وصلح النظر وصلحت العين صلح القلب، وكذلك العكس، إذا صلح القلب صلح العين وصلحت العين وصلحت سائر الجوارح.
And the connection and the relationship between the heart and the eyes is a very unique relationship that they have. And therefore, if the eyes are upright, then that will cause the heart to also be rectified and to be sound, and that would cause our actions to also be sound. And likewise the opposite. If our eyes and what we are looking at is corrupt, then our heart will also become corrupt, and that would cause our actions to also become corrupt.
لا بد من معرفتها، وهي مكيدة من الأعداء. ما هي هذه المكيدة وما هي هذه الحقيقة؟ أن هذه الصور التي يراها الناس وخصوصا الشباب هي ليست على حقيقتها، إنما هي مزينة من الأعداء حتى تجعل الناس يتبعون هذه الصور. ومن العجيب أن هذه الحقيقة تكلم عنها ابن مفلح رحمه الله الحنبلي في الآداب أو في الفروع، قال: الشيطان يريك ما لا تقدر عليه على غير ما هو عليه. قال: الشيطان يريك ما لا تقدر عليه على غير ما هو عليه. هذه الصور التي نراها، أو يأتي الشيطان ويزين لنا أن ننظر إليه، هذه الصور المحرمة نحن لا نستطيع الوصول إليها، لكن مع ذلك هي على غير ما هي عليه، يعني محسنة مزينة. وكذلك الصورة التي تكون عابرة حينما يمشي الإنسان في طريق، فالشيطان يزين لك هذه الصورة. فهذه حقيقة إذا تأملها المسلم فإنه بإذن الله عز وجل سيعرف مكائد الأعداء ويزهد في مثل هذه الصورة.
And here is a reality that we need to ponder over, which is that within this is a plot of the enemies. And what is this reality? This reality is that these pictures which are impermissible, these pictures which are haram, that we may see, especially the youth, then these pictures, the reality is that picture, what you are seeing is not a true picture of the thing that you are seeing anyway. In fact, it has been made more beautiful in your eyes, it has been changed just to draw you in so that you look and you continuously use the websites and so on. And what is strange is that Ibn Muflih, Al-Hanbali, rahimahullah, he talked about this in one of his books. And he said that Shaytan, he shows you things that if you are not able to attain, then he beautifies that to you. Or he changes how it looks to you. So if you see some of these pictures, and obviously we cannot go and attain what is in that picture, Shaytan, what he does is that he beautifies that picture even more to you. And likewise, this whether it's on our phones, on our devices, even if you were going outside and a picture was on the street and so on, then the reality is that picture, what you are saying, is not a true picture, it's not a reality. Rather, it has been made more beautified just to draw you in and to and for them to use you. So this is something that we have to ponder over.
والسؤال المهم أيها الإخوة الذي لعلنا نختم به وأظن أن هذا السؤال يعني ربما وارد على أذهاننا جميعا ونحن في هذا اللقاء.
And we got a question now, and hopefully inshallah we'll finish with this question. And maybe many of us were thinking regarding this question, and the question is
السؤال كيف أغض بصري؟
The question is, how can I lower my gaze?
كيف أجاهد نفسي على غض البصر؟
How can I fight myself from trying to lower my gaze?
أولا علينا أيها الأحبة أن نراقب الله جل وعلا وأن نخشاه وأن نخاف سبحانه وتعالى، نتذكر دائما نظر الله إلينا، نتذكر عظمة الله جل وعلا، يعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور، ويقول جل وعلا، يقول سبحانه وتعالى: وما قدر الله حق قدره والأرض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامة والسماوات مطويات بيمينه سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. نتذكر وصية لقمان الحكيم لابنه كما قال الله عز وجل حكاية عنه: يا بني إنها إن تك مثقال حبة من خردل فتكن في صخرة أو في السماوات أو في الأرض يأتي بها الله إن الله لطيف خبير. علينا أن نتذكر هذه، نستشعر عظمة الله جل وعلا ونستشعر أنه يرانا في كل أحوالنا، ونستشعر أيضا الخوف منه والخشية، وأنه قد يختم للإنسان والعياذ بالله وهو على هذه
The first of these ways is that we have to acknowledge and remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is supervising over us and He is observant over us, and therefore we have to have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and of His punishment. And constantly remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see us, and also ponder over the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَعْلَمُ خَائِنَةَ الْأَعْيُنِ وَمَا تُخْفِي الصُّدُورِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything that the hearts and the eyes are hiding. And likewise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَا قَدْرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. That the people have not truly venerated Allah as He should be venerated. وقد حق قدره والأرض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامة والسماوات مطويات بيمينه. And in the, on the day of judgment, all of the heavens and the earth will be rolled up in the right hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, ponder over the advice of Luqman al-Hakim that he gave to his son, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated in the Quran, where he said, يَا بُنَيْ إِنَّهَا إِنْتَكُمْ إِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ فَتَكُمْ فِي صَخْرَةٍ. That even if it's a mustard seed in the middle of the desert, even something small as that, يَأْتِ بِهَا اللَّهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will still bring it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is observant over everything. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَطِيفٌ خَبِيرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is soft and generous, but at the same time is khabir, He is all knowledgeable of everything that is taking place. So therefore, we need to constantly remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is observant over us and He can see us in every moment in our life, and that should cause us to have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And maybe, we need to ponder that maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala therefore decides to take our life whilst we are in that state of sinning Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from that.
Allah azza wa jal alimun bina, khabirun subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa huwa latifun bina. يعني يرانا على المعصية فيسترنا سبحانه وتعالى, يرخي ستره علينا, فعلينا ألا لا نغتر حينما يستمر الإنسان في معصية والعياذ بالله, ولا يرى أنه قد ابتلي بشيء, فليعلم أن هذا من لطف الله وأن هذا من ستر الله عليه. وكل منا يقع في الخطأ, لكن الواجب علينا أن نتوب إلى الله, أن نؤوب إليه سبحانه وتعالى, أن نجاهد أنفسنا كل ما رجعنا إلى ذنب, أن نجدد التوبة ونصدق مع الله سبحانه وتعالى.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all knowledgeable regarding all of the actions that we do, but at the same time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is generous and gentle with us. He sees us disobeying Him, but at the same time, He conceals that sin that we are doing. So therefore, we should not be deceived that just because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not taken us to account yet or punished us for a sin, do not be deceived thinking that you are safe from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But rather, this is from the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He decided to cover up and to conceal the sins and mistakes that we are doing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned within the ahadith that all of us make mistakes, all of us sin. But what is obligatory upon us, what's obligatory upon us is that we return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We repent back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that we fight ourselves to make sure that we don't fall into those mistakes again. And if we do fall into those mistakes again, then again we renew our intention of tawbah and repenting back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قيل لأحد السلف كيف أغض بصري؟ قيل لأحد السلف كيف أغض بصري؟ قال أن تعلم أن نظر الله إليك أسبق مما تنظر إليه, أسبق من نظرك إلى ما تنظر. قيل لأحد السلف كيف أغض بصري؟ قال أن تعلم أن نظر الله إليك أسبق من نظرك إلى ما تنظر إليه. وهذا لا شك مما يعيننا على غض أبصارنا, مما يؤدي بإذن الله عز وجل إلى سلامة قلوبنا.
It was said to one of the Salaf that how can I lower my gaze? It was said to one of the Salaf, how can I lower my gaze? And he said to know that the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes before your sight, i.e. what you are looking at, before you have even looked at it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knows what you are looking at. So subhanAllah, this is something that we need to realize. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what we are doing, and therefore we need to come back and turn back to Him.
إلى غير ذلك من الآثار الصحية وغيرها التي يعني يطول الحديث عنها, لكن في الختام فإني أذكر ببعض, إضافة إلى ما ذكر, هناك بعض ما ينصح به للآباء والأمهات في البيوت, وكذلك مما يعين الآباء والأمهات الإخوة الكبار والأخوات الكبار في البيت في الأسرة، أن يعني نقنن استعمال أبنائنا لهذه الأجهزة، ومن ذلك ألا يسمح مثلا بدخول هذه الأجهزة إلى مكان النوم. إذا أراد الأطفال أن يأخذوا مضاجعهم من النوم تمنع هذه الأجهزة، لا بد من الحزم في هذا الباب، لأنه إذا تركت هذه الأجهزة معهم حتى في مضاجعهم وفي مكان أماكن نومهم فإنهم ربما لا ينامون، وهذا خطير جدا. الأمر الثاني أن هذه يعني مثل ما يقال نسميها يعني التحكم في الإنترنت، أن يكون له أوقات محددة وأوقات معينة، ألا يكون مطلقا، متى ما شاء هذا الابن أو البنت أن تدخل على ما شاءت، لابد أن يكون هناك تقنين لهذه الأمور. الأمر الثالث، لابد أن يكون للأسرة جلسة بعيدة عن هذه الأجهزة، بأن تقفل جميع الأجهزة وتكون عندنا جلسة ولو ساعتين إن شاء الله في الأسبوع، لو ساعتين في الأسبوع تكفي في أول أسبوع وفي آخره، جلسة جميلة يتجاذبون فيها أطراف الحديث، يستمعون إلى كلام الأب، يستمعون إلى كلام الأم، يتناقشون فيما ينفع هذه الأسرة بعيدا عن هذه الأجهزة تماما. هذه من الأشياء التي يوصى بها مع العناية بسلامة القلب والعمل على صلاحه. أسأل الله جل وعلا بمنه وكرمه أن يصلح أحوالنا وأحوال المسلمين، وأن يصلح بيوتنا وبيوت المسلمين. اللهم يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث، أصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من الفتن ما ظهر منها وما بطن. اللهم أعذنا وأزواجنا وذرياتنا والمسلمين وأزواجهم وذرياتهم من كيد الشيطان وتوهيمه، إنه على كل شيء قدير، والله أعلم. وصلي اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.
And there are many other negative side effects to technology, whether due to our mental health or physical health, and we don't have time to mention all of them right now. However, that which I will conclude with bi-idhnillahi ta'ala is some advices for the parents, for the fathers, for the children, and for the fathers, for the mothers, and even maybe the children who are older in age, to stick to help the family come over some of these negative side effects. The first is to control the usage of the phones with our children, and to make sure especially that they do not take their devices and their phone with them to bed, because that has a very dangerous effect upon them by them maybe looking at things when they are by themselves which they should not be looking at, or maybe them just using their phone and then not being able to sleep during the night. So this is something which is very dangerous, and this may be something difficult to implement, but it's something that you have to have hazard forbearance upon and you have to be strict with. Number two is to also control the amount, maybe what they, maybe the Wi-Fi, what they are able to go on and look at on the internet, and also what times during the day they are permitted to use the phone. It should be something that whenever they want, they are able to just take their phone out and use it. And number three is that the family should have a weekly gathering, at least minimum 2 hours a week, that's the bare minimum, at least 2 hours a week, a gathering where the whole family sits together without any of the phones present. And they listen to what the father has to say, they listen to what the mother has to say, they maybe discuss any issues that is a means of benefit for them as a family, or in society or on an individual basis. And this should all be done with no phones, no advices present and far away from all of those things. Maybe one gathering in the beginning of the week, and one in the middle, and one at the end, and so on. But at least a minimum of at least 2 hours a week. And therefore, with this, we come to the conclusion of this lecture. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to rectify our hearts and to keep them pure. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rectify the affairs of the Muslims and to rectify the affairs of our households. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to lower our gaze and to grant us that which will benefit us and to protect us from all sorts of evils. And with this, alhamdulillah, we have concluded the lectures of both of the Shaykh.
جزا الله فضيلة الشيخ الدكتور على هذه التوجيهات التربوية الدينية والتي كل بيت يحتاج إليها. وأود أن أذكركم ونفسي بأننا مسؤولون أمام الله يوم القيامة. وسأذكر لكم في هذا الباب آية وحديث. فأما الحديث فيقول صلى الله عليه وسلم: كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. وأما الآية فإن الله تعالى يقول: يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة عليها ملائكة غلاظ شداد لا يعصون الله ما أمرهم ويفعلون ما يؤمرون.
Shaykh Muqbil, hamidahu Allah, he just added on firstly by asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward for the Shaykh Abdul Shamani, hamidahu Allah, and what he has mentioned regarding and how or the importance of preserving the household. And the Shaykh said just one thing to remember as well is that all of us are responsible and all of us will be held to account for our responsibilities and the rights that we have to uphold on the day of judgment. And for this point, I will mention to you one ayah and one hadith. As for the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then he said, "Kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'oolun an ra'iyati." That all of you are shepherds, and every shepherd of all of you will be asked about or regarding their flock. Meaning, you are all in charge, and you all have responsibilities, and you will be asked by Allah regarding that which you are responsible for. As for the hadith, as for the ayah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who believe, who anfusakum, save yourselves wa ahliikum nara, and also save your families from the hellfire. Wa quduha an-nas wal hijara, that hellfire with the fuel of the hellfire is man and stones and rocks. عَلَيْهَا مَلَائِكَةٌ غِلَاظٌ شِدَادٌ لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهَ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ. And guarding or around the hellfire would be great angels who never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all they do is obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with that, we have concluded and finished the two lectures of the mashayikh. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward both of them, and we also send our gratitude to both of them for taking their time out and traveling all the way here so that we can benefit from them.
جزاكم الله خير. جزاك الله خير مهدور. كيف حالك؟ كيف صحتك؟
Our brothers, if I could just ask you to sit back down because we will take some questions and answers, inshallah. Any questions for the shuyukh that have come today? Please speak up on today's topic. Fadl Hamad, Shaykh Khalil, you'll have to translate.
كيف توازن بين طلب علم ودعوة ونية الإخلاص؟
أولا يبدأ الإنسان بطلب العلم، فلا يمكن أن تبنى دعوة إلا على طلب العلم. ولكن أيضا مع طلب العلم يخلص أنه يطلب العلم هذا لله عز وجل لإزالة الجهل عن نفسه أولا، ثم يدعو إلى الناس بما عالما من هذا العلم ويدري، لكن لا بد أن يكون عالما، أن يتعلم العلم، ولا تكون دعوة صحيحة إلا بالعلم. فاعلم أنه لا إله إلا الله، استغفر لذنبك.
So the question was, how do we combine between seeking knowledge and giving da'wah? And the Shaykh gave a very concise and small answer, where he said that the first thing that we have to do is start to seek knowledge. And when we are seeking knowledge, we be sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our seeking of knowledge. So we seek knowledge to remove ignorance from ourselves firstly. And then after that, we can seek knowledge to remove ignorance from others. And know that our da'wah cannot be correct and it cannot be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if it's not based upon correct knowledge and upon the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
لهذا أن من يفتي أو يدعو بغير علم سيكون ضرره أعظم، ولهذا بعث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سرية فأصابت أحدهم جراحة واحتلم تلك الليلة في ليلة باردة، فقال لأصحابه: هل تجدوا لي رخصة أن أتيمم بدل الاغتسال؟ قالوا: لا، مع وجود الماء. فاغتسل فمات، فأخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بذلك، فقال: قتلوه قتلهم الله.
And therefore, the one who gives da'wah and calls the religion of Allah without knowledge, he will cause more corruption than what he rectifies. An example of this is when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent a group of companions, and on their journey, one of the companions had become injured and he had hurt himself. And then during the night, when they were resting, he had a wet dream and he was in a state of janabah. So therefore, when he woke up in the morning, he asked the other companions that, do you find a concession for me that I can do tayammum instead of washing myself due to the injury that I have? And those companions who were with him, they said, no, because we have water. We should not need tayammum if there's no water, but we have water. Therefore, you have to use water. And then what happened is that he used water to bathe himself, and that eventually was a cause for him to become ill and to pass away. And because of the injuries that he had, it caused him to pass away. So then when the Prophet ﷺ was informed of this, what did the Prophet ﷺ say? He said, they killed him, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fight them. So whatever they did to him, Allah Prophet made the same dua against them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did the same thing to them. And what was the cause of this? They gave an answer without knowledge.
قد نبه الإمام محمد بن عبد الوهاب عليه رحمة الله في ثلاثة الأصول على مسائل أربع: العلم والعمل والدعوة إليه والصبر على الأذى فيه. فالعلم لا شك أنه سابق، ولذلك ينبغي لطلاب العلم أن يحذروا من أولئك الذين يصورون للناس أنه لا بد من الدعوة ولو بدون علم، ويقولون مقالتهم المشهورة: ادعو إلى الله قبل أن تتعلم فإن الله سيفتح عليك. وهذا مخالف لمنهج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وللمنهج الحق. وبعضهم يستدل بقول الله عز وجل: واتقوا الله ويعلمكم الله، فيجعلون التقوى فقط بدون علم، بدون أن يبنى العمل على العلم، أنه منهج سديد، وهذا ليس بصحيح. فلا بد إذن أيها الأحبة من العلم. لكن إذا تعلم أحدنا علما أو استفاد فائدة، شرح آية أو حديث، فإنه يجمع بين العلم وبين الدعوة إلى الله عز وجل بتبليغ هذه الفائدة إلى محيطه. ليس معنى ذلك أن طالب العلم أول ما يبتدئ طالب العلم لا بد أن يذهب إلى المنابر ويدعو الناس على المنأ. يبدأ بمن حوله، ببيته، بزوجته، بأولاده، بأقاربه، وهكذا. والله عز وجل قال: واتقوا الله، وقال عز وجل: والذين اهتدوا زادهم هدى وآتاهم تقوى. فإذا تعلمنا فلنطبق ولنعمل، ثم ندعو إلى ما تعلمنا بقدر ما نستطيع، ثم نصبر على ما نلاقيه في هذا المجال. والله أعلم.
And also we need to remind ourselves of the four points that Sheikh Muhammad Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah mentioned in the beginning of his book Al-Usul al-Thalatha, that the four things, and we will take on Usul al-Asr as well, that the four things that we need to do is first we need to learn of ilm, knowledge, and then action upon that knowledge, and then call to that knowledge, and then have patience upon all the difficulties that come upon this path. So as you can see, the first thing mentioned here is knowledge. So therefore we need to be aware of certain people. Sometimes people, they come out and they say that you should, the most important thing is giving da'wah to the religion of Allah even if you do not have knowledge. And this is something which opposes the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some of them may say that give da'wah to Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open up doors for you. And without knowledge is something which again goes against the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some of them may use certain ayat where they say, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهُ. Have a taqwa of Allah and Allah will teach you. Therefore, if you just have the action, the knowledge will come. And that is an incorrect understanding of this ayat. So therefore, if a person learns something, a benefit or meaning of something, then there's no problem in a person conveying that message to those who are around him. But that da'wah does not mean that person, a student of knowledge in the beginning stages, he needs to start to get upon the manabir, upon the member, or start to take a position in society and so on to give da'wah. Rather, he just starts to inform those who are around him, and whoever learns and seeks guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase it in even more guidance, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions within the Quran. Any more questions? Take one more question, inshallah.
Can the Sheikh give any advice or even practical steps for somebody who's already addicted to the device and they know that it's a problem and they want to stop and they've been struggling trying to do that but they find themselves
in the difficult situation? بهذا ويحاول يتوقف ثم يريد يتوقف من يريد.
لا شك أن الإدمان على هذه الأجهزة والنظر الحرام أنه مصيبة، لكن على المسلم ألا ييأس من رحمة الله عز وجل. عليه أولا أن يجاهد نفسه على ترك هذا البلاء. الأمر الثاني عليه أن يصدق في توبته وفي افتقاره إلى الله وفي لجئه إلى الله عز وجل، وأن يطرح بين يديه سبحانه وتعالى، يسأله المغفرة، يسأله أن يخلصه من هذا البلاء. فإنه بإذن الله عز وجل إن صدق في توبته وافتقاره إلى الله وإنابته إليه مع المجاهدة، فإن الله سيعينه وسيوفقه وسيخلصه. الله جل وعلا هو القائل: وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعاني. ويقول جل وعلا: أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. الله عز وجل على كل شيء قدير، لكن يريد منك أن تقبل عليه، أن تصدق في توبتك. حتى لو رجعت إلى هذا الذنب فارجع، تب إلى الله عز وجل وجاهد نفسك. وأيضا مما ينصح به أن يقطع وسائل الشر. يعني مثلا يعني على سبيل المثال، شخص يقول: أنا مدمن النظر عبر وسيلة معينة من وسائل التواصل، لأن هذه الوسيلة البلاء فيها كثير. فمن وسائل أو من الأسباب التي تقطع هذا الشر أن ألغي هذه الوسيلة. يعني هناك وسائل أخرى لتواصل مع الناس، لكن هذه الوسيلة التي أوصلتني إلى هذا البلاء وليس عليها حماية أو رقابة، فإني لو قطعت هذه الوسيلة ولو مدة فإن هذا من العلاج للنفس. إذا كان الإنسان مثلا عنده صحبة حديثهم وطريقتهم على هذا، فليبتعد عن هذه الصحبة وليختر أصحابا صالحين. فالله عز وجل إذا علم منا هذا كله والمجاهدة وبذل الأسباب فإنه سيعيننا جل وعلا، والذين جاهدوا فينا لنهدينهم سبلنا وإن الله لمع المحسنين.
The question that he asks, what is your advice regarding the one who is addicted to looking at these things which are haram, even though he knows it is wrong and even though he tries to stop and he returns back to it again and again? The Shaykh answers that without doubt being addicted to things like this is a great calamity upon a Muslim. However, it is firstly upon him not to despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then it's upon him to do al-mujahada, for him to strive against his own soul, to fight his own desires, to leave off this trial and tribulation that he is in. And then with that, with him fighting his own desires, it's upon him to be truthful in his repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only with all of the conditions of repentance, but he's truly truthful to Allah and he falls down in a state of need to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he begs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, and he begs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to free him from the calamity that he is in. And if a person is truthful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst taking the means to stop that which he is falling into, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will definitely help him. And why? How is that not the case? Whilst Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who said, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. That when my slave asks about me, or asks regarding me, then let him know that I am near to him. I will answer his dua. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ. That who is the one who answers the supplications of the one who is in a state of need? The answer without a doubt to this rhetorical question is that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you is for you to be truthful and you to turn back to him. Even if you end up falling into that sin again, if you are truthful, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to go back to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also one of the things that we would advise as well is for you to cut off all of the means that will take you to that sin. So for example, if you know that there's a certain application on your phone, and by you using that certain application that causes you to fall into haram, then what you do is that you delete that application. And if you need to speak to anybody, then there are other means and there are other applications which are available for you to contact other people. Likewise, if you have a friend group and the topics they talk about revolve around these topics which causes a negative effect upon you and causes you to think about these things, which is a means of you entering into that haram, then you need to cut off those people and try your best to stay with the people who are righteous. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُولَنَا. And those who strive for our sake, meaning we strive hard for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُولَنَا. Then we will guide him to our path.
ولا تقنط يا أيها المكثر من الذنب وكلنا كذلك. قال الله تعالى قل يا عبادي الذين أسرفوا على أنفسهم لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا. فكلما أذنب العبد يستغفر ربه ويكرر ذلك. وكلكم خطأ يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام وخير الخطائين التوابون. فليحذر الإنسان من المجاهرة بالمعاصي أمام الناس، فإن هذا من أخطر وأعظم الذنوب. كل أمتي معافى يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام إلا المجاهرون يعملون المعاصي أمام الناس لا يخافون من الله ولا من خلقه. فأسأل الله أن يتوب علينا جميعا ويغفر ذنوبنا.
Shaykh Muqbil Hafidhullah, he adds on that we shall never disturb from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Say, O my slaves who have transgressed against themselves, لَا تَقَنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair from the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins. Verily He is all forgiving and all merciful. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ said that all of the sons of Adam make mistakes and commit sins, but the best of those who commit mistakes are those who repent back to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also we need to beware of publicizing our sins, because this is from the greatest of sins is that a person, he mentions his sins publicly to the people. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that all of my ummah are forgiven except for the ones who publicize their sins. So therefore I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of our sins. And with this we will conclude our gathering. Bismillah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward the two mashayikh who have come and taken a time out to benefit us. And likewise to reward all of you for taking a time out to come to this gathering. Subhanahu wa ta'ala.